Good afternoon, everyone. Hope everyone's not sleepy yet. I saw some people leaving. Can you all hear me? Is this better? Cool. So, I'm Ram. Today I'm going to talk about something I'm really fond of, which is basically Android, and specifically design for Android, because I've seen its evolution for some time, and wanted to talk to all of you about some experiences that I've had over the last 4 to 5 years in designing for Android. So I thought I'll talk a little bit about myself first. I'm basically from Madras. I've been born and brought up there, and I've been living in Bangalore for the last 5 years or so. And like any cliche designer would do, I sort of put out a timeline of places I've been since 2009. And currently, I'm working with a startup incubator called Coastal Labs aims to solve large-scale problems in India across several domains, like mobile payments, retail, healthcare, being some. And primarily, I want to sort of share some of my perspectives on design in general, and three really important values that I've learned. The first being sensitivity. So, sensitivity, according to me, is caring who you're designing for, moving pixels, really taking care of and feeling towards what pixel perfect design actually means, choosing the right shade of color, or choosing a color scheme, and basically connecting with people. And to talk a little bit about how I learned that sensitivity is important was through a project that I did in my recent past with a company called Frog. And we designed this, along with a small set of friends, we designed this suite of apps and services for this company called Jaipur, which was an e-commerce startup. And they their main goal was to enchant people with stories about craft. And they sold products of craftsmen through these stories. And as you can see, it was an Apple-centric sort of approach that they wanted. And this was the first, sort of my first experience in knowing what it means to really care for the details. How many of you sort of relate to this? Does anyone recognize what this is? Pardon? No. So in the design process, this is basically speccing out, writing design specifications for your visuals. We also call it redlining. And it's a fairly laborious process, because you need to take care of every pixel that you're creating. And to any designer, to some designers, I should say, me being one of them, this could be a nightmare if you're doing it for a very long time, because it's a very time-consuming and very sort of boring process, to be honest. But over time, this sort of made me understand what it is to value each pixel and why people would see beauty in that. Sometimes it really shows when things are off by even one pixel. I would show some examples in some of my later slides. And this is actually a friend of mine who, his name is Alvin, who worked with me on this project. And basically, I wanted to share with all of you that sensitivity is not just about caring about work or about your perspective towards work, but it's also about the people you work with. And you got to really know who you're working with and understand where they're from and basically connect with them at a relationship level. So, and the second value I learned, which I connect to at a subconscious level, is taste. I might be an ass to say that taste is something that people either have or not, but it's usually it's towards different things. Like I may have taste to something, and my taste would be different from someone else's taste, and it automatically doesn't mean that the other person does not have taste, because the other person has taste in different things. And there is also the sort of, I wouldn't call it a concept, but acquired taste, where if one is exposed to a certain environment for a long time, then they would feel emotionally towards things like food or things like color or things like music, for example. And an example of that is the art of color picking. For me, that's something that I usually do based on my situation or based on my mood or where I've been to at that point. And it usually comes from the gut. It's an question of intuition. And a lot about that, about taste in general, can be sort of hinted through a documentary I watched sometime last year. It's called Jiro Dreams of Sushi. It's about a Japanese sushi maker who's really passionate about his work. He's pretty old. I think he's probably in his 80s. And he still makes sushi every day in Japan. And this is a quote from that documentary. All of you should watch it at some point if you get a chance, if you already haven't. I really connect with the second bit, which says the quality of ingredients is important, but one must develop a palate capable of discerning good and bad. One can always argue what is good and what is bad, but in the overall sense, when it comes to taste, you would either frown or smile when you think of something, and that is actually taste. And another value I learned was humility, which actually has been through some funny experiences and interesting experiences I've had over the last 4 years. And it's something that is usually learned over time. And it's learned over time by working with people from different cultures, people from different backgrounds, and entrepreneurs, engineers, designers, creative directors. The more people you collaborate with, the more you learn and the more humble you become. And at least for me, collaboration I've found that leads to really fruitful results. And how I came to learn about this was through a story I wish to share with you, which happened during my design college days. And this was during a color and form course. And as you can see, I'm a fan of Batman, and I tried to show a color and form transition of the Batman logo symbol. And during my semester jury in design school, I had a panel of 4 or 5 people, and one of them was a really senior, an old designer who has been with the college for a very long time. And he asked me a question towards the end of my presentation, asking me, "So what have you learned, Ram?" And I told him the basic things anyone would tell, met friends, learned a lot about design and things like that. But I ended with a note of saying that, I forgot to mention, he was our professor for color and form. So I told him I really enjoyed the color and form course. And after your course, I actually felt that my sense of color has improved. And that's when someone got up from the panel and told me that Ram, Professor Parmar, in his 50 years of service, not once has he uttered those words, "His color sense has improved." And starting that day onwards, working with different people, I learned what it is to sort of value humility. And that's why I feel sensitivity, taste, and humility are really important qualities for any designer, because we never stop learning. We should never stop learning. And I'll leave everyone with this quote from one of my favorite authors, Carl Sagan. He's written a book called Pale Blue Dot, Apart from Cosmos, which basically talks about the universe and the human's relationship with the galaxies and stuff. So next I'm gonna show you something a little different, a little bit more about things I value and things I care. If you ever get a chance to work together in the future, this might be immensely useful for all of you, which are basically the South Indian thali. I love rice. Taking apart Android phones bit by bit, and of course Batman. Let me jump right into it. I'm sure I would have bored everyone already. Today I'm going to talk about two really important aspects when it comes to Android. The first being, how do you care when you're designing for Android, and how do you care for details? Let's go into Android. I want to once again touch upon Android's philosophy for a moment. They started off really young. Everyone knows, right from the G1 days to the Nexus 5 today. And how I see this evolution is it's just change. Android is about change. Every year, new things come out, not only in the UI, in terms of technology, in terms of platform. So just the constant need to change is a mindset which might be worth just zooming out and thinking about for a second. And today, even things like, it's grown beyond the phone, right? It started off with the phone, and today people are thinking about new use cases for it. It's gone to wearables. People are sending phones into space to do research. Universities are exploring robotics. Lots of interesting things are happening in Android. And just to get out of that bubble of, let's not just think about phones or apps, let's go back and see what it was envisioned for, and then it might be easier for us to know how important it is to design something after that. And so how do we do this? How do we go into Android design? Some of these things that I found useful in my experience are definitely designed for a specific culture. It's very important because people have different behaviors, people think differently. Your idea of how something should work might not really work for everyone. Design for scalability, which means don't just think of design as a process towards the end which says, okay, let's just make this pretty. But think of how long it will be used for and how valuable it will be. And pick your own process, which means different companies work differently, or if you're working on your own, as most of us here are entrepreneurs, we might be used to a certain way of working, but the ability to say, let's change that so that things work best for that moment is really important. I'll jump right into it. What do you mean by design for scalability? Designing is not just about designing screens, wireframes, and apps. When you think of design, think of your entire environment. Think of the organizations you're working with. Think of the processes they follow. Think of what they do. Do people talk at all in the organization? Do they communicate with each other? Do they hang out? Do they get to know each other well? Think of how other people see what you're building or who you are, which is your identity, which could be your brand, your website, the people you work with, partners, apart from your products and services, which is the core of what everyone's used to and what I've been used to all these years. And maintenance, because once you build something, it's out there, people are going to use it. And design is for people. They have to feel comfortable. They have to feel happy, delighted. So think of how that life cycle of post-usage and post-updates and improvements could be as well. So when you think of all these things when you're sitting and either designing or creating or developing or testing an app, or anything for that matter, you will make sure that it will be more informed and it could probably survive the test of time. Just to touch upon something that most of us are familiar with, Android has guidelines, everyone's used them, some of them don't use them. It's important to know the rules first. Like, once we know the rules and understand them, like Pooja's talk spoke about what it means to understand something first before you actually get down to doing things. Because once you know the rules, you can break them, and you'll break them right. I wanted to show another example of something that we've spoken about in the design process. Everyone must be aware of that. If not, there is a design process where one would start from research and go on to figuring out how concepts are built, and then how designs are built, then how they are fine-tuned, and how they are tested, and how you get feedback from the users. So that's a generic design process in a nutshell. But an example I want to talk about are flows. How do you define tasks? How does one task blend into another one? And this example is basically a small shopping sort of an app where you have a list of items and you want to add them to your cart. So first you search for these items and they show up. As you can see, I think they're detergents and stuff. But to add them to cart, you can either tap on the small add button at every list item, or assuming that you want to change quantity, you tap on the left side and you get a quantity selector. And you can then add that many items to the cart. Now, what if in some cases you want to add loose items like rice or dal or something? The only difference here is that once you tap on an item to change quantity, you tap on the quantity to change it to a loose item quantity. So you want 1.5 kilos of rice. So I just wanted to touch upon the fact that when you think of flows, right, think of tasks basically. Search, add items, and then you add it to your cart. Or search, add items, and then change it to loose items, and then you add it to cart. So what this conveys is that you break anything down into simple contextual tasks. It need not be just screens. It can be anything. It can be about your website. It can be about your marketing material. It could be anything. And don't overload a task with features, because there could be several ways of changing quantity for loose items, right? Maybe that's not the ideal way. Maybe there is an ideal way. But the minute we start adding new features to each task, the overall flow gets really bulky, and you lose users in that process. People won't find it useful to use. So that was about flows. And the next important thing is about color. Sorry. For this, I would like to show an app by this developer called Nadav Fima. It's an app called Cliffhanger. It's free. You can download it on the Play Store. I just wanted to sort of, I really appreciate this app for its usage of color. If you can actually, if you've used the app or seen the app, it's basically just one main color. It has a lime green, and it has one accent color, which is red, which is minimally used. But all the other colors are shades of gray. So there isn't actually five or six colors being used. The actual sort of photogenic feel of the app comes from the content itself, which are photos of the TV shows. So a combination of these actually make the app look really clean and beautiful. So when you think of adding colors to your visual design, you don't necessarily have to go all the way by choosing 7 or 8 colors. And the other thing is about typography. Typography is again something that's very taste driven, as I would call it. The point here is that when you're designing something, you don't need to use a lot of gradients, you don't need to use a lot of shapes to make things beautiful. Just plain content up front can make things look really pretty. And the way in which content is laid out, as Pooja was saying also, in terms of priority or in terms of hierarchy, that really shows what people should look at first and understand. So, and about iconography. So think of what kind of icons you want to use. A lot of people use flat icons these days. It's become a trend. But think of whether you want real shapes, or you have to be abstract, whether it's 3D or flat, whether it's detailed or simple, because these decisions will impact that whole environment I spoke about before. What if you're printing out a small envelope and you need an icon? Will a detailed icon work in that case? Probably not. So the decisions you make when you think of the larger system will impact your entire design process. So to summarize, we've seen designing for scalability is design. Think of design language rather than just beautification. And these are the items. So what do you mean by designing for a specific culture? You can probably give icons in text fields because people may not understand English, a semi-literate audience may not understand English. Or think behavior, where this behavior is really common in India. You have signs written on walls, lampposts, advertising things. Or even the way people use phones. People use dual SIM cards in India to save money. They have multiple phones, they have shared phones, and you have the missed call culture. So it's really important for the audience you're designing for. They have certain behaviors. It's important to know what those behaviors are, because only then will your design be sort of thought through. This is an example of someone storing their music collection. A lot of us store it on our computers through folders of artists or genres and things like that. But this particular person had an interesting way of storing music through the people they got the music from. So if Kiran gives me a music, there would be a folder called Kiran. And that's how that person relates to music. So all these behaviors are really sort of important to know, as I mentioned. Then there is trust. When you're designing something for people, the first thing you ask is, how can you make them trust you? How can you make them trust what you're making? An example of that is the khata system in Indian shops, where if you don't have money and you're buying something, the shop owner says, okay, pay me tomorrow, I'll just write it down. That's because they know you and they trust you. So these kind of behaviors are really important. How do you generate trust? Make things clear to them, make things apparent, don't hide things. Let them do what they're already good at. And specifically in India, things like adding brand logos or recognized brands actually work. Like if you're doing a payment service, if you have a public bank logo somewhere, that people are going to trust you more. So think of those kind of things. So to summarize, think people using technology and not just technology, because in the end, that's what really matters. And what do I mean by pick your own process? Get feedback from as many people as is humanly possible. You need not just get feedback from your peers, get feedback from the development teams, the support teams, the marketing teams, or even your parents, your siblings, even someone who passes by on the street, if at all that could work. And think of ways in which you can improvise. That's Jugaad. Don't think just always in process. And a little bit about iteration, and this is an example of how I've been used to iterating design. I don't do, like, say, weeks and weeks of wireframe revisions and then handed it over to the development teams and then work with them to get it created. The first design would always be created, but the rest of the iterations would be done in code directly. So some of my friends, developers, I work with them to sort of make sure that actually the design changes in wireframing actually happen in the SDK in code. And a way to do that is basically let the developers share their drawable folders with you in Android. Because then the designer actually controls the drawable folder. You can make changes there directly. You can add things to it and inform them, rather than always zipping assets and sending it to them, or if you have a better workflow for doing that. And there are some tools that even let you automate this. This one is called Cut and Slice. It automates asset generation in Photoshop. You can check it out. It's cutandslice.me is the website. And this is a video. There's another paid tool called PNG Express, which I'll skip due to the lack of time. And to summarize, when you think of a process, think context, what works for you and what works for that process you're building for. Which is basically talking to a lot of people and making sure you have an efficient process to iterate. Let's get into the next section, which is about care in detail. Here, I wish to talk about some really finer grain details on how you can step it up a notch. How do you go beyond just designing for the usual process? An example that inspires me is the Japanese toothpick. If some of you would have seen this, it has a small set of wedges on the side. And what it's used for is basically, once you've used the toothpick, you can break it to indicate that it's already been used, or you can keep it on a table and rest the used toothpick on it. So it's a really nice way of paying attention and detail into something as simple as a toothpick. And how do you go about doing this? How do you go about paying that much attention in your work? Pay attention to content, and think of things like transitions and animations. So getting into content, really think about spelling and grammar. This is, I think, one of the earlier boxes of the Galaxy S2 for the Indian market, where they had a typo right there in front which said Super AMOLED Plus instead of Super AMOLED. And that really stands out. You should be able to sort of pick these small errors everywhere and make sure that they don't happen, because people see them. And when people see them, it's really bad for the product or whatever you're sort of making. Think of tone of voice. A friend of mine actually designed this. This is the Cloud Magic Mail app, which is newly launched. The sort of tone that you wish to give, make it friendly, make sure people appreciate it, make sure people connect to it. Things like a quick heads up, it may take a few minutes for things to settle down. Just to give you a hint, rather than saying loading dot dot dot. Think of consistency, an abstraction. Consistency is basically when Google is probably one of the many examples, but it's a pretty fairly reasonable example where their flight card that shows up in Google Now, to just before you get on a flight, it gives you just the right information at the right time, as they call it. It works consistently even across platforms. Like even when you open a ticket in your email, it shows the same kind of card. So people expect that in every case, like you shouldn't change expectation. An abstraction, which basically means that don't show all that extra information in a ticket which isn't really useful. Show exactly what is needed. And that, those are things that you actually think about when you're thinking of content. Think of accuracy of content rather than just placeholder text. Most designers use lorem ipsum for everything, so. Lots of other products like Zomato, ClearTrip, Feedly are good examples of presenting good content. And think about detailing, which basically is, I don't know if all of you can see this clearly, but there is a 1 pixel mismatch in some of Google's own icons. And this could be due to various justifiable reasons, but just the fact that they are not consistent, the ability to pick that 1 pixel out is really important. And even sometimes, this doesn't happen on all phones. I think it's a layout issue, which is basically a small pixel level mismatch in the calculator app. You've seen this? I think in some of the smaller resolution phones, this doesn't show up, but in the bigger XX HDPI phones, it is just off by 2 or 3 pixels, and that's just not right. And that is sensitivity. I mean, feeling that it is not right and wanting to do something about it, that is key. And this is the newly launched Newsstand app, which I really liked an animation there I wanted to share. Is basically, as you're scrolling up, the icon that shows up for that category just sticks up to the action bar. Or this other app called Expense Manager, where when you're adding your expenses and you discard it, it just drops down. So these smaller level details that might not be really important in the process or in the beginning of developing an app is actually really important. It makes a difference in the end, because when someone's using it, that's what interests them, that's what delights them. So to summarize, think microscopic, not only in screens. Going back to that slide of the environment, think about this level of detail in every aspect of the design you do, because that's what shows. And having said all of that, I'd like to sort of wind up, because I think I've overshot my time almost. First, we spoke about care in Android, which is basically to help everyone think holistically of the platform and then see how these principles apply to how you can actually design, and how do you step it up a notch when you go into details. So one sort of encompasses the other. So initially you need to have the basic design principles like scalability, working for a specific culture, all of that working. But then you add the other layer of detail, because that makes your, that actually differentiates what you're creating from everything else. Hope these stories like shed some light into helping everyone make meaningful and compelling ideas come to life. Any questions?
What font are you using?
It's a question of taste. I've just used Roboto because I kind of like it. Yeah.
So I noticed you're using Roboto right at the start. I'm looking at this and says, okay, someone's using Roboto. That's interesting, because the use of Roboto outside of Android has been fairly limited. It's a font that doesn't really work well on low resolution displays, especially like a projector screen. It's designed for high res. So I was curious about why you chose to use that for slides.
For some reason, I actually connected with the font's symmetry in some way right when Ice Cream Sandwich came out. I felt that the combination of weights was something really worth playing with. And I wouldn't say it's the best font I would choose, but it's something that I like. And since this, I wanted to talk about Android, I thought it's just obvious that I go with Roboto. Of course, I had a different font before I actually finished the presentation. It was called Benton Sans. So, yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
In multiple set of questions. How do you design for design the button sizes for different finger sizes? How do you design when you keep left-handed, right-handed people in mind, or the people who prefer to use your app with a single hand instead of both the hands?
Correct. So we could logically approach that in one way of doing things. And the other is just seeing what works well just by gut. It's very important to obviously first go through the layer of logically creating that by saying what is the minimum touch affordance for the sort of device you're using, which could be like 48 device independent pixels or even more than that. But then after you actually go over the basics, you go beyond what the guidelines are, what the basics are, you actually see for what you're building contextually if what you're feeling is right in terms of the size you use or the placement you use or where, how many times you're using it. Things like one-handed use, so you won't obviously keep them too far apart. But those are basic logical decisions that have to be sort of thought about initially. But on top of that, use your layer of gut. Like, use what you feel is the best way to do it. So I would do it that way.
Hi. I had a small question. You spoke about designing for culture, which works for a whole host of, you know, applications and products today. But a lot of things that we design are not for one culture. And, you know, just the fact that we are putting them out there on something like the Play Store means that, you know, you can't say, so you're not Indian, this app was not for you, you can't download it. You know, you can't do that sort of a thing. So how do you sort of work with the friction between designing for one culture and designing things which, you know, a large number of people actually understand well or know how to use?
Really.
Yeah, so one of the first ways in which that actually affects you is when you simply move from a left to right to a right to left reading order.
Correct.
Your whole layout changes then. How do you deal with that?
Then again, it's a problem that can be approached both logically and design-wise. Logically, the first thing would be to sort of design a universal layout that would work for both. It's probably just one of the methods you can choose. Probably there is a better way of doing it. To see if you design a universal system, how easy it is to adapt to the cultural system if a change needs to be done. Say, for example, the left to right or right to left. But the other way of doing it is actually thinking about how you're presenting content. Don't restrict yourself to layouts. See if there is a better way to present content and choose that mode instead, because that mode would most be most appropriate to that culture. Like saying, I'm trying to see if an example I can give.
What about the use of icons?
Pardon?
The use of icons as a way to transcend cultural barriers.
Definitely. And one thing about usage of icons is that you can always debate to say if an icon actually communicates something to a specific culture. But there is always a small learning curve in technology. If you see how mobiles were adapted in India, people really did not know how to use smartphones, but they used it anyway to do. And it just took a couple of weeks to months to sort of go over that learning curve because the need was so great. So if the need of communicating something through icons is that great, then even if the icon is not exactly probably suiting that context, assuming that the learning curve would be overcome, and it would be a much more effective approach than probably localizing text, because you can't localize text for all cultures, right? Because sometimes you can't just do a translation or a transliteration. You actually need to rephrase or present content differently for a particular language. So, I mean, did that help?
So yeah, you guys were talking about icons and how, you know, I mean, I suppose it's very easy for, let's say, urban people across the world to understand the same icons. But it's very different if you suddenly start to look at people from, you know, different places. I mean, I have a friend whose mom is a designer and she works with rural people in India. And they once did this really simple icon for saying that, you know, when you put water in a ghada outside your house, make sure you cover it. So they made a simple ghada and they put a line over it, which they figured would look like a plate. And then they put like a tick sign over it. The people in that village had never seen a tick sign. They thought when you keep water in a ghada, you should cover it and put a spoon on it. Like, it was something that was so completely out of the realm of their visual vocabulary. And we are so sort of caught up in the narrow bubbles right. That we live in. We don't even realize that there are people who live maybe 200 kilometers away from us who don't know what a tick is. And that's fine, but, you know, we use these icons not realizing that that actually happens.
So in many ways, it's really important to understand that visual vocabulary, because only if we understand that language and speak the same language, or at least put ourselves in their shoes, we'll know what would be useful to that audience. Like from an urban perspective, it's very easy to just use a tick mark, but just that decision to use a tick mark itself is wrong. So one must take the time and effort to sort of know what it means to sort of know that culture and then make something for that. I'm sure that would be the ideal approach.
So I've been, studying visual communication on digital media, so per se, website or mobile apps and stuff for the last 3 to 4 years, more so as an entrepreneur. Since you mentioned sensitivity, in your presentation, I feel that there could be some kind of a correlation between the tone of voice as well as the color story. Mm-hmm. So I'd like your views on it.
Then again, I think it really boils down to what you're trying to convey and how would people find that enchanting. So if you're trying to use a specific tone of voice to bring about a friendly perspective to someone, to say that make what you're building is approachable, then you can make that, perhaps you can make that better through the addition of color as well, if that's what you meant. Or
more so to do with solid colors, right? I mean, I find that, solids per se, like blue, green, and also the darker tones, mm-hmm. They don't go too well with a more affable personality when it comes to the tone of voice.
You're talking about the intensity in colors itself.
Yes, yes.
Of course, you can definitely experiment with that too.
Okay.
I think to make something really stand out, you use, probably a lot of people use bright.
Right.
But then again, that's culturally independent, like that works differently for different
sure.
cultures.
Yeah.
I think we have two more minutes. Any questions? Yes.
Hi, Ram. Vijay here.
Hi.
Just a quick question on the recent changes in the UI side. That's flat UI design concepts. What I felt is, for example, when Apple actually drastically changed from their previous design language to flat concept, so it looked like they changed it and then started building a story behind the change of the language. So what's your take on it as a designer?
I'm sure they would have thought through a lot of these aspects, but I mean, I have to agree with you when you say that it hasn't been thought through entirely. Sorry. Sorry. And that it's something that somehow I see it as the absence of the visionary right now is causing a lot of change which they're going through. And of course, that's just my opinion. I'm sure that will also evolve over time. Anyone else?
Thank you, Ram.